Let's talk about the LGU-led vaccination efforts. You have called, actually, the inclusion of local government units and private sector representatives in the national task force. You want the LGU to be frontline, so to speak, in the rollout and in the planning. Ano ba ang kulang ngayon sa inyong pananaw? And do you feel the IATF is centralizing too much?
I would say so, Karen. It's a fact that the membership of the IATF has been confined to cabinet members. They're good. They've been confined to persons probably who are not well grounded, so to speak, insofar as problems of the barangays, the poroks, the municipios, and the cities are concerned. So I had proposed that there should be an active membership coming from the group of local governments, either it be ULAP or not just membership in a subcommittee, but an active membership in the central IAT.
In the planning itself.
Planning, execution, operations. If you remember the Gwen Garcia incident.
Exactly.
That could have been avoided. If you remember the previous incidents, and modesty aside, I even called for the inclusion of mayors and governors as frontliners, because they were given, they were about to be sued because some of them were vaccinated ahead of the other. So, but they've been going around. So thank you for the decision, IATF. But there has got to be an active member. They can even be a co-chair. They can even be the co-chair, because if you look around, Karen, the rollout, the vaccination, the database, they're all coming from the LGUs, and the burden would be LGUs again. So it's just appropriate that LGUs should be at the forefront. And the same is true with the business sector, whether it be the Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Makati Business Club, they should be at the forefront likewise, because look at what's happening now. They imported several thousands of AstraZeneca, Moderna, for their employees to spur the economy. So I think these two groups were neglected for a long time, the local government sector and the business sector. And they are still at the forefront of this COVID-19 fight, Karen.
Oh, you mentioned Governor Gwen Garcia, and she has, they even had a special session in Cebu, but now they're forced to follow the IATF rules. And to some people, what Cebu was doing also made sense based on their own issues in Cebu, wherein when you arrive, they give one swab test. After 3 days, basta if you test negative, you end up quarantining at home. And on the seventh day, you take another test at home. But now what the IATF has directed is that you quarantine in a government facility, right? In a licensed facility, so to speak. And you have Cebu fighting that and saying that it was too expensive, mental health, and they would like to send people at home and quarantine at home. So that's a classic example of LGU versus the IATF.
Correct. There has to be no friction with the guys, so that they should work in tandem. But I guess when it comes to local situation, when it comes to local assessment, evaluation, and what to do on the ground, LGU has to be supreme, because they know what's happening on the ground. So look at the current thinking right now of IATF. All of them are my friends, Karen. They're now agreeing to the idea that lockdowns should be LGU initiated. No regional lockdowns, no national lockdowns. It has to be LGU focused, because they realize that the local government officials are more attuned to what's happening on the ground. They have the barangay health workers, they have the local health officers, etc., etc.
Okay, but ULAP at one point was calling and asking the IATF to let the LGUs decide on the testing requirements upon entering an LGU. So I want to ask you about that now. Nung panahon na kasi yon, it was so strange that Baguio City allowed tourists for swab antigen. But La Union, that's right close to Baguio, was requiring RT-PCR. And now, the IATF requires all that before you move to an area, it's RT-PCR. But if you go to Batangas, you're not required to RT-PCR. If you go to a dive resort or hotel, it's just an antigen test. So this is where it gets so confusing, even Tagaytay. Diba? I mean, you're not requiring an RT-PCR to eat in Tagaytay, for example. So this is where it gets confusing. And you have the DOT hoping it weren't like that, but that's the rule. So paano yun, Senator Tolentino, if the LGU has the say and the IATF makes this requirement? Ano ba final?
So you're speaking of lack of uniformity here.
That's
You're speaking of a lack of cadence insofar as LGUs marching in tandem with what the IATF has been barking. But again, I think I still support the proposition that LGUs are supreme insofar as the local situation is concerned. But it will again at the end of the day will have a congruence of what's best for Baguio, what's best for La Union. It will match, Karen, because these are the pandemic really is it's a testing ground for good governance methods, but not just for good governance method, but for health responses. And no one has a monopoly on this. You look at in other jurisdictions, some states are open, some are closed. So why don't we just allow the IATF to have the national protocols, procedures in place, and leave it to the LGUs to choose from the menu of IATF procedures which one to follow?
Really? Yun ang gusto nyo?
What is applicable to them?
Palagi mo, papayag ang IATF dyan?
Imaras. They can have face-to-face classes.
You're right.
Biliran, they can have face-to-face classes. Batanes, they can have face-to-face classes. Camiguin, they can have face-to-face classes. Why follow the rules of other regions or areas where COVID-19 is really on the surge? So I don't see the real basis for this. So this is where the friction or conflict would occur, Karen. But sad to say, we have to follow this. But again, with the Mandanas ruling about to be implemented, the empowerment of LGUs, I think they will be flexing their local autonomy muscle, so to speak, in the next few months. So we have to prepare for this.
Okay, I'm curious. You gave a very strong recommendation on face-to-face classes, because I know many schools, many parents that already believe that some areas are ready for face-to-face. And you're right. So I'm curious, during your time with the president, the times you're with him, have you ever brought this up with the president? Because I know that Secretary Briones and some senators, your colleagues, the DepEd themselves were already naming certain pilot areas for face-to-face, and the president just said no.
I think there should be areas wherein face-to-face classes would have to be implemented, like what the CHED has been doing for nursing, medical schools, among others. It should not be a total online hybrid modality. So it won't work, Karen. It never worked. Even with that World Bank report that they later on apologized for having issued prematurely, I think there is a basis that, and this will be confirmed, later on that the learning accumulation of our pupils really went down during this online modality system, Karen. So why don't we give it a try? May bakuna na naman yung ibang teachers. Yung mga lugar lang na safe.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. I was going to move on to the West Philippine Sea. Were you done with your thought? I'm sorry.
Yes. There are really difficulties being confronted by DepEd. Mahirap talaga yon. But we have to move on.
Okay. All right. The West Philippine Sea. You have been quite vocal on several issues in the Senate. You filed, as what I've read so far, you've filed three international resolutions on the baseline law, renaming the West Philippine Sea, renaming Philippine Rice. But you also have strong views on the Mutual Defense Treaty. So are we using or exploiting or benefiting from that treaty enough?
I think we should do more. We should benefit from the continuation of former President Trump's policy, which was enunciated lately by the U.S. Secretary of State Blinken, that the United States would come in aid and defense of the Philippines, no matter what. And I think this is the opportune time to really revisit the Visiting Forces Agreement. Add more meat.
Like you want it strengthened?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Add more meat and follow the examples of the other countries. And Karen, I would want perhaps the DFAs, they're listening, or even U.S. Embassy, there are other venues wherein the Philippines can really participate and be an active member, and this would strengthen our position in the West Philippine Sea. I cite two. There is a Quad Agreement, and the Quad Agreement involves the countries U.S., Australia, Japan, India. We can be a member of that, just like Vietnam. We can take advantage of that, and this would involve naval exercises within the West Philippine Sea. It's up to us to join that. We have yet to hear from Secretary Locsin on this matter.
But I wanted to ask you very quickly. Clearly, even if you support the president, I'll be honest. You have different points of view with him. I'll ask you one thing: would you want the Visiting Forces Agreement to already have some semblance of permanence? Because right now, technically, it was suspended. Then the suspension was suspended. So it's an every 6 months agreement for the president to implement the Visiting Forces Agreement. You have some sectors already, including the United States, asking for some permanence with the Visiting Forces Agreement. Do you believe it's time for the president to already decide?
The extension, I think, should be conceived as an advance notice or a harbinger that the president is really taking this seriously. And on my part, I would support the notion that we have to strengthen this on the basis of our national interest.
Okay.
What would entail the elevation of our national interest vis-a-vis the presence of U.S. forces, even temporarily, in the Palawan area, Fort Magsaysay area, among other places mentioned in the BFA or EDCA.
So, okay. Yeah.
We have to take advantage of the continuation done by President Biden, of President Trump's policy. So it's the ball is now on the part of Malacañang, and I support a strengthening of the VFA.
Okay. Now, you also mentioned the Quad Agreement And the Quad Agreement involves naval exercises within the West Philippine Sea. I asked Secretary Lorenzana on Head Start after his conversation with Blinken, why not have naval exercises with the United States given the conditions today where China has strengthened their presence in the West Philippine Sea? And you still have the same response from this government. They don't want to agitate China, and having naval exercises with the US could aggravate the relationship. So you don't agree with that? Do you believe it's time to have naval exercises with the US?
With all due respect to Secretary Del Lorenzana, there is a forum for this. He is a member of the ASEAN Defense Ministers meeting. This is a forum for defense ministers. And China is a member. This group was established in 2019. China is a member of that group, and that's the proper forum to discuss all of these issues in his mind right now. But for us to really strengthen and promote our national interest, being a member of the Quad should be a step in the right direction. But Karen, I stumbled into, and this is new, okay, I stumbled into something which is perhaps,
in the MDT.
Yes, stronger than the MDT right now. Oh. Because the MDT would require any attack on our metropolitan area would result in a response coming from the United States. But there is an active treaty, Karen, and mm-hmm. you will know this firsthand. There is a Southeast Asia Collective Defense Treaty signed September 8, 1954. And I hope DFA is listening, wherein, in case of an armed aggression or threat within the Southeast Asian territory, responses would come not just from the United States, but from Australia, France, USA, Great Britain, and even New Zealand. So this is a stronger treaty, Karen, and I have it in my possession. So this treaty would entail responses from Thailand is even included. And my research led me to conclude that this is still a valid treaty. And if the DFA can prove me wrong, I will abide with their expertise. But for me, this is a valid treaty. This led to the creation before of CETO. CETO was the counterpart of NATO. So CETO was abolished, but the treaty remains. So if we advocate and insist that the treaty is still valid, and the Philippines is they call it the Manila Pact, and the Philippines is a major a pillar of this treaty, I think this would help our position in the West Philippine Sea. I'm not drumming up the war sounds, but this would strengthen the position of the Philippines achieved through that arbitral ruling.
It's okay. And I'm curious, with the presence of Chinese maritime vessels in the West Philippine Sea today, do you believe that the Southeast Asia Collective Defense Treaty can already be activated? Because it seems it has to be an act of war. But that may not happen already. This is the post-Cold War era, so to speak. War would cost even, experts say, the issue is not to expect a full act of war, but what would one consider as a threat? So would you consider the presence already as a threat?
The exact language of the treaty calls for the appropriate means to thwart any attempt in the treaty area to subvert their freedom or destroy their sovereignty or territorial integrity, quote unquote. And this is all encompassing. It's not just your armed threats, but even economic threats would be subsumed, Karen. So I think it's about time that we really look into the the extent and validity of this treaty, whether this is still in place. But from even the website of the U.S. State Department, it is still valid. They still recognize this treaty. So it is valid insofar as the United States is concerned. It strengthens our MDT, and if it is valid insofar as Australia, which is nearby, we're in a better position.
Okay, so my last question with you, sir, as we are running out of time, but isn't really the problem the president himself? I mean, honestly speaking, he is the author of the country's foreign policy. He is the leader. He is the chief. And he is taking a direction wherein it doesn't harness all these treaties. He's even said that the arbitral ruling's just a piece of paper. So isn't he frankly the problem, Senator?
No, again, I refer to the banters and badinage expressions of coming from the president. But I think it will be clear. At the end of the day, it would be clear. We will have a more phlegmatic foreign policy environment. It will be clear. I think it's just a matter of time. Whatever the president does, I think it won't prevent China from drumbeating. It won't prevent China from insisting on the 9-dash line. It won't prevent China from not participating in any arbitral proceedings. So whatever the president does, I think it will redound to the reflection of the people on whether he did it for national interest.
Okay. On that note, we don't have enough time, but next time I speak with you, there's still so much to talk about with you regarding the West Philippine Sea. So sa susunod, Senator Francis Tolentino.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
All right. God bless you. You stay strong, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
All right.
Thank you.